You're probably all familiar. We've had a booth over at the book fair over there, so we're kind of in a Spartan thing here today. Not normal for us to be no logos up here or anything, but we're very fortunate to have Chris Mooney to come today and give us a talk. He's quite an accomplished individual. He has podcasts. He's written four books. The Republican War on Science, it was a bestseller on the New York Times. The one that, of course, he's going to be presenting today is one that I think you're going to be very interested in as well. He has good arguments as to how the Republican brain tends to work. Now, obviously, it's going to be controversial, and that's not all bad. We like a little controversy once in a while. And he can show that there is basically a different way of looking at things by people who don't want to believe science and rationality sometimes. So I think you're going to find that this is going to be a very stimulating discussion. And he's a very, very accomplished at working with people and scientists and all, and being able to communicate in a very effective way. So I think we're in for a real treat today. And he is doing a book signing. He still has a few left after the performance today. Why, if you're interested, he'll be in the back waiting to sign the rest of the books that he has. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Chris Mooney. Give him a big hand.
Thank you. Thanks, Jerry. Thanks a bunch. Here, I'm gonna need this, so let me just get this out. Okay. So I am sorry about the timing thing. Commitments at the festival, commitments here, they just got like mixy. So I do apologize for that. But it's a privilege to be here to tell you a little bit about my fourth book, The Republican Brain. At the outset, let me say that I know that this is controversial stuff. And I say that at the outset because I want to tell you who to blame if you're angry. And the answer is not me. You should blame all of the scientists who keep publishing papers about the differences between liberals and conservatives in psychology journals and other kinds of journals, because it's getting to be a really big literature right now. And I'm only reporting on it. So if you don't like it, blame the scientists. And just to demonstrate that, you know, I wrote a book version of this, but here's an article version, which was in, it's when I move. Yeah. Okay, so here's an article version of it, and this is in Nature, which is one of the leading scientific journals and also magazines. What you see is that here's a journalist reporting on genes, hormones, and how they shape your political views. I did it book length, but this is someone who's interviewing a lot of the same people and reporting what they're finding. So this is within the genre of journalism, journalists reporting upon what scientists are finding. Finally, I will say that the scientists themselves who are finding it have said that I'm describing what they're finding accurately. So I was on Up with Chris Hayes on MSNBC when the book came out, and I was on with Jonathan Haidt, who has a very good selling book on a related topic, which is about the moral foundations and impulses of liberals and conservatives, and I'll show you some data of his. And he says, Chris has done a great job of surveying the literature. I want to give him a stamp of approval. He's not cherry picking. He's representing the current state of thinking about politics and personality. And this whole episode, it's actually 20 minutes long. We get into a long discussion, him and me and Chris Hayes, is actually on YouTube. So you could Google Mooney, Hayes, and Haidt, H-A-I-D-T, and you would get that whole discussion where it basically he says, yeah, I haven't gotten it wrong. So let me tell you why I got into this area. I used to misunderstand political conservatives. The people who disagree with me, I knew they disagreed with me. I didn't really know why. And in fact, being a self-described liberal coming from the political left as a political and science journalist, I had this understanding of what I thought was motivating them that I now think is really incomplete. And it's sort of the typical liberal misunderstanding of your opponents where we think, oh, if they believe this, it must be because of religion, right? They're all religious, so they're all, a lot of them are Christian conservative, so if they're denying the science of evolution, religion's the cause. Or, but there's all this other science denial that isn't apparently related to religion, like the denial of global warming. So here, it must be the case, I reasoned, that, oh, it's the money. It's corporate interests. It's really wealthy funders who are underlying this. So if you want to understand what motivates conservatives, you follow the money or you follow the religion and you will understand them. And that is the approach that I took in my first book, The Republican War on Science. This was 2005. It was about the Bush administration. And I like to tell audiences that I was not trying to echo the cover image of another popular book that was out at the same time. So we only noticed that later. And this was about the Bush administration and science and all of the anti-science things that happened under George W. Bush, who was constantly misleading and dissembling about what we know about global warming, who cast doubt on evolution, who basically set forward a stem cell policy that was not based on good science. And if you really want to understand George W. Bush and science, I think there's one quotation that sort of captures it perfectly. It was right after the 2004 Christmas tsunami killed hundreds of thousands of people, I think we all remember, in the Pacific Rim region. And Bush was doing his first press conference after the tsunami, and a journalist asked him, Mr. President, the journalist asked a scientific question. Mr. President, does the United States have a warning system in place for the purpose of detecting tsunamis that might affect us? Okay, forget about it all the way around the world. What about us? How are we detecting tsunamis? Bush had absolutely no idea how we were detecting tsunamis, but he tried to answer anyway, and so he sort of stumbled and hemmed and hawed, and then he finally said something scientific sounding again, which was, he said, I think we might be less vulnerable to tsunami risks than the rest of the world. But he then quickly cautioned, I am not a geologist, as you know. And I think that really... I think that kind of captures the Bush minister. What's going on over there? Okay. So I think that captures the Bush era and science and the relationship between the two. And so a lot of us thought, hey, here's this guy, President Obama. He talks a really good game about science. When he gets elected, or if he wins, then this whole problem of misuse and abuse of science is going to decline and go away, and won't it be great? That was a really naive view, because we started to have things like this, right? And I mostly tracked the climate change issue closely, and you saw something really amazing with respect to this, which was that as the science demonstrating global warming is caused by humans getting worse, I mean, the magnitude of the problem is unspeakable right now. The stronger the science got, the stronger the denial got among the conservatives. And that was not something that I was really at the time ready to handle. So I started to think about much more deeply about why people deny what's true, what motivates that, and why it seems to live so frequently on the political right, although I don't deny that it can emerge also on the political left. But why is there so much of this on the right? And the Republican War on Science, as I told you, it had its explanation, its account for why this might be the case. And that's an account that I would now call a political account or a political story, and also an environmental story, not in the sense of, you know, clean air and clean water, but in the sense of a story about nurture rather than nature. Because what I was doing is what journalists always do, is it's attribute the political behavior of the group that you're analyzing or critiquing to the socioeconomic and political environment in which all of this is happening. So if the Bush administration, or if Republicans deny the science of global warming, deny the science of evolution, they are majority creationist party, and a majority global warming denier party. If this is the case, it must be something about the interest groups that they have to appease, for instance. So again, that's the Christian right. That's corporate America. That's really rich people. So there must be that motivation to carry water for the people who put you in power, and that must be the reason why. Now, is that wrong? No, there's a lot of truth to it, but it's only a part of the story. And let me show you some data suggesting that it is a very important part before we go on to what the new book is about, which is the other part of the story. So just last year, long after the Republican War on Science came out, Gordon Goshat, a sociologist, published a study in the American Sociological Review, basically using a new data set to test my argument. And it's really fun, if you're a journalist, to see, you know, Mooney 2005 cited throughout an academic paper. It's kind of gives you a little bit of thrill. But he's saying, is Mooney 2005, in other words, is my book, correct about conservatives and science? Let me test this by going to the General Social Survey, which is this gigantic repository of public opinion data, and do something that someone hasn't done before, which is, let's take apart this question they always ask. It's called the trust in institutions question. So how much do you trust the military? How much do you trust doctors? All the difference, how much do you trust government? How much do you trust Congress? How much do you trust journalists? And Congress and journalists are always like down at the bottom, right? Nobody trusts them. And military is very high. Scientists are very high. Medical profession is very high. So what he does is he just breaks down the response to the scientist question, how much do you trust scientific institutions, by political ideology. Which someone, for some reason, no one had bothered to do that before. So you got 30 years or more of data, and you've got blue is the liberals, red is the conservatives, black is the moderates. And what you see is that over the last 30 years, the conservatives marched downward and downward and downward in their trust in scientific institutions. So something is happening in American politics that's turning conservatives off of trusting science. And so I agree, there's something going on in the political environment, because when you get a quick change over time like that, that really has to be something about the political environment, the dynamics of politics, the way issues are covered in the media, the way they're discussed. So that is definitely important and definitely real. But at the same time, I was realizing that, hey, there's no way that that could be the whole story. And the reason is that there's just too much evidence suggesting that politics is not just nurture. Politics is not just the environment. Politics is also nature. There is not a blank slate, as Steven Pinker convinced us, and it turns out that our political beliefs are deeply embedded in who we are as people. And the research is really growing on the biology and the psychology of politics. And so what my new book, first book didn't consider, and what my new book goes back to consider, is the growing body of evidence. And by the way, a lot of our political classes and our journalistic classes do not want to face this evidence. The growing body of evidence demonstrating that liberals and conservatives are just different kinds of people. They're different kinds of people, and they're different in ways that go far beyond and that seem to be prior to their actual ideology. And then it looks like people are pushed or nudged in a way that they're not really conscious of, to accept certain views and to reject certain views because they feel right. They feel congenial to who you are. And this happens over the course of the lifetime. Most people are still unfamiliar with this research, but once I became familiar with it, once I became steeped in it and I interviewed all the scientists, I thought it's impossible to ignore, and it casts a heck of a lot of light on these battles over science and what's true in not just the scientific arena, but in, say, the economic arena, or when you're debating whether the president was or wasn't born in the United States, all of these kinds of things. It looks like our political beliefs and our factual beliefs are related to a set of traits, personality traits, psychological traits, even some physiological traits, that's what the research is now focusing on, and also these different moral systems and different moral intuitions that Jonathan Haidt researches. And these are traits on which people differ, and the differences seem to be at least partly inherited or passed on from and traveled in families. Now, I want to be clear. The fact that liberals and conservatives, and it's very important to say on average, because you will definitely find many cases in which they go against the grain, but this is a statement about averages, that there are different kinds of people on these measures is a fact. You know, there's too much research now suggesting it's true for anybody to deny it. What you make of the fact is really up to you. I think the fact itself is value neutral. What you make of it, you could use it to say there's something wrong with conservatives, or you could use it to say there's something wrong with liberals. Neither is actually true. I mean, these are, you know, none of this is any kind of abnormal psychology. This is variation within normal psychology, is what they explained to me. And a lot of it casts very, very negative light on liberals, as I think we'll see. And some of it also casts a light on conservatives that could be negative, or at least could be seen in this situation, this conservative trait is not a benefit. And that's really how it works most of all. In this situation, this liberal trait is probably not a benefit. And when it comes to grappling with science, that's where I think liberals really do have the upside. But let's deal just with the reality right now. So this idea that our political beliefs are somehow inherited or part of our core underlying dispositions or related to something deep in who we are, that's not a new idea. Like all good ideas, it has a very long history. And to show that, I'm giving you an image about the comic opera Iolanthe, which is by Gilbert and Sullivan, 1882. And in here, there's a verse which contains this idea long before there was any real science to back this idea. And by the way, the writings of Thomas Jefferson also suggest that he was thinking along these lines, going back even farther. But here's the verse. And I gotta pronounce it a little weird to rhyme because I think the pronunciation of the English language has changed. Since then, nature always does contrive that every boy and every gal that's born into this world alive is either a little liberal or else a little conservative. Okay? This observation is clearly old, but it is not widely accepted. We want to think about politics from a blank slate perspective. We kind of tacitly assume that, you know, if I have a certain set of views and my neighbor has a different set of views, we each came to it because we reasoned our way through the issues, but we just ended up with a different conclusion. Or maybe it's we had a different upbringing, and if I had been just raised by Republicans, I would be one, which I now kind of doubt is the case. The new science certainly casts a lot of doubt on the idea that that would work out that way. Because if we really came to our political beliefs by reasoning about the issues and that was where they came from, then why would you find so many differences between liberals and conservatives that have nothing to do with politics? Why would you find differences between liberals and conservatives that, say, show up in how they organize their bedrooms? Okay. Liberals are messier. But what does that have to do with politics? But I mean, I think we all kind of know it's true, right? And there's actually a study on liberal-conservative bedroom organization. Or, and this is all psychology research, right? Or why would they have different artistic tastes, different aesthetics? It's not political, is it? But there's a paper in the psychology literature about conservatives and liberals in art, and the conservatives seem more attracted to representational art, AKA landscape painting, portraiture, that kind of thing. Things that look like things look like, right? And liberals are, you know, versus conservatives, are find abstract art more appealing. Like, what does that have to do with ideology? Or why do they have different senses of humor? You know, why do they find different things funny? The good news is that they both find Stephen Colbert funny. The bad news is that they find him funny for very different reasons. I'm summarizing another psychology paper that's in the literature. Conservatives, well, let's go with liberals first. Liberals think he's funny because he's a satire of a conservative, right? Conservatives think he's funny because deep down he's one of them who hates liberals, all right? What's up with that? And the list of apolitical differences between liberals and conservatives just goes on and on and on. In a business psychology journal, there was recently a study by a group of, actually it's a regular psychology journal, by a couple of professors of marketing who looked at sales data, okay, consumer products data, across a huge number of US countries, counties. And what they found was a really big difference between liberals and conservatives in how much they bought, you know, highly well-known brands versus either generics or new products within the same product category. So you could picture conservatives are buying Tide, okay? And liberals are much more likely to buy the generic in-store brand or the new brand. So conservatives are more wedded to these established brands. And they'll go on to say, you know, it looks like conservatives like to drink Budweiser and liberals are, you know, much more likely to drink Guinness. You know, so they've got all these different behaviors that filter all through aspects of life. So what is up with that? Because there's another thing that the research shows, and just sticking with beer for a second. It also looks like there's various kinds of interventions or, you know, things you do that change your body or change your state of mind that change your politics. In other words, people don't stay at one political set of beliefs. You can push them, but you don't push them by arguing with them. You push them by doing things like getting them drunk, which seems, so again, something physiological and biological is going on when you get drunk that seems to change your ideology. And let me tell you how we know this. It sounds like a joke, right? Group of psychiatrists go into a bar. Group of political psychologists go into a bar. They actually set up outside the bar. And they had breathalyzers, and they had political questionnaires. And the questionnaire included a basic question, are you liberal or conservative? And the assumption of this study is that no matter how drunk you are, you still know the answer to that. But then there's a questionnaire that it contains questions about your substantive views on the way society should be structured. Things like, do you believe property rights should be absolute? Okay. What they find is that both liberals and conservatives shift to the right in correlation with increasing blood alcohol content. That it works for both groups. Okay, so why would that be the case? And why, for that matter, would you get a very similar result if you ask that same kind of questionnaire of people when in the background there's a hand sanitizer? What is it about priming people with the thought of physical cleanliness and killing germs on their hands that shifts them to the right? Because this experiment has also been done. And we all know that there's one thing that shifts people to the right across countries extremely reliably, and that is making them mortally afraid, making them think that they're gonna die. Their country is under attack. If you wanna make a country shift to the right, just attack it, okay? And that when that happens, people do not want nuance, they don't want civil liberties, they have a black and white conflict view, and they want a strong leader who's going to attack the enemy. And then all of politics, and again, liberals shift to the right too in this context. I was one in Washington, D.C. after 9/11, and I can tell you I shifted to the right. So what is this thing called ideology, and why is it so tied to these seemingly non-ideological aspects of human biology and psychology? Where does ideology live? It's going to live in the brain, and the most controversial research is brain studies. I want to emphasize that I think that the brain research, the actual brain scans of liberals and conservatives, this is too young of a field for one to base really strong conclusions on it. There's all kinds of critiques of popular neuroscience, and I'm not actually operating in that genre. People think that I am, and they say, oh, Mooney's, you know, yet another one of these popular neuroscience people who doesn't understand the science. Yeah, right. All of the nuances that they have in those articles taking down popular neuroscience are in my book. They just haven't read it. So who's actually nuanced? You can question that. So we should be very cautious about brain scans, but they are finding differences between liberals and conservatives. I will just tell you the kinds of things that they're finding, but I don't think this is definitive. I think that what is definitive, or what really makes you turn your head, is when a huge body of evidence from different fields all points in the same direction, which is what is happening here. And this is just one part of the evidence, and it's one of the weakest parts of the evidence. Nevertheless, here's a British study, University College London students, and they find that conservatives have got more gray matter in the right amygdala versus liberals in the anterior cingulate cortex. This study, you can't see because I didn't write out all the authors, but one of them is Colin Firth, which is very strange, right? And they asked him, what are you doing with these scientists? And he said, I wanted to figure out what was wrong with the people who disagree with me. And so the scientists actually found something. It's great. So the right amygdala, different parts of the brain do many things, but the amygdala is an evolutionarily conserved fear and threat center, okay? We share it with other animals, and across these animals, the amygdala is the part of the brain that controls fear and controls fight or flight. You know, when you are under attack, when you are under threat, it takes over, and you might think it runs an automatic response program that is happening faster than you can even think of it, and that is to protect you from harm. It does other things too, but we know that it does that. The anterior cingulate is different. Anterior cingulate is a part of the brain that is associated, among other things, with stopping a habitual pattern of behavior and changing and doing something different. So, you know, something that that's automatic because you do it so many times, our behaviors, our habits become automatic. This is an area of the brain that tells you, wait, no, don't do that thing that you always do, do something different. And it snaps you to consciousness. So there's some sort of left-right difference going on here, apparently. It's very interesting. I don't think we should base big conclusions on this, but what I do think is that we should turn to the body of science that is decades old and quite consistent, showing that liberals and conservatives have different personality traits, okay? And to show that, let me show you some of the kinds of questions that we actually used in one of the studies that I did. I'm a reporter, but I actually work with some political scientists to design one new study at the end of the book. And these are the kind of questions we use to assess personality. They're the kind of questions that are used to assess personality using not Myers-Briggs, which has, you know, a lot of scientists question the validity of Myers-Briggs, but this is to use the Big Five personality scale, which I'll tell you more about. So we ask people how much they agree or disagree with these two terms or phrases to describe them. And you rate yourself on a scale from 1 to 7, from disagree strongly to agree strongly. So how much do you see yourself as artistic, a highly abstract thinker? I know you're all rating yourself. I'd rate myself pretty high on this. Okay, and you move on. How much do you see yourself as dependable, self-disciplined? I don't know how highly you guys are rating yourself on that. How much do you see yourself as open to new experiences, complex? And it goes on like this for some time, and there's a variety of different terms to describe you. And what you're getting here is, as I said, a Big Five personality test. So this is what you then get as results. This is not our results. This is another paper that was looking at Big Five personality tests in liberals and conservatives. The blue, I've colored it blue to show you the kinds of traits that tend to make one more liberal. And the red is the kinds of traits that tend to make one more conservative. And I love this chart. It shows so much. Because what you've got is you've got the Big Five traits, and I'm going to tell you more about them. Conscientiousness, openness, agreeableness, stability, and extroversion. But you've also got two more sociological characteristics of people, their level of income and their level of education. Right? And then you've got three different kinds of ideology. Okay, so you've got overall ideology, but then you have economic views and social views. And what you see here, first, let's stick with income and education. Not surprisingly, these have a big effect on ideology. We all kind of knew that. If you are wealthy, okay, if you tend towards having a high income, then especially on economics, you tend towards conservatism. No big surprise, right? Although it doesn't tend to make you socially conservative. If you have a relatively higher level of education, you know, some college beyond, it tends to make you more liberal, and it tends to make you liberal in terms of your overall self-identification and in terms of your social views. Again, no surprise, but actually might make you a little conservative economically because you probably have a higher income. I'm sure this and this are related. What's really interesting is that personality traits, which we don't usually associate with politics, are having as big of an effect, in some cases a bigger effect. So, conscientiousness. This is the one that tends to make you more conservative on all three types of conservatism. And that's one of the questions to get at conscientiousness is how do you rate yourself on that dependable self-disciplined scale? Conservatives tend to rate themselves very highly. Conscientiousness means, in this context, it means liking order and stability in your life. Okay, this is also why their rooms are less messy. Right? Think about, you know, a guy who goes to the job, works for a corporation, wears a really nice, crisply starched shirt every day with a perfect shave, okay? And gets there on time and drives to work the same way every time. Openness. This is the one that has a big effect on all kinds of liberalism. Openness is novelty seeking. It's wanting to try out new experiences, new friends, new ideas, new places to visit, new restaurants to go to, seeing a lot of movies, listening to all different kinds of music, You know, life is a smorgasbord, and you want to sample everything. That's what an open person. Some in some cases, you need to sample everything. There's an open personality type called a sensation seeker, and they just can't get enough, right? The other big five traits are not as big of a deal in politics, but I will note that this is not all good news for liberals, because here you got stability, and conservatives are higher on stability. The opposite of stability is neuroticism. Okay, so again, not good news for liberals, they're neurotic. This is a really large study with more than 11,000 people. So what this says to me is that politics is personality. Okay. And personality, we know, is partly genetic. How does this explain the battle over reality? We know that being open to new experiences and having a relatively higher level of education make you liberal. We know that money and wanting structure in your life or order make you conservative. What about denying reality? I think a lot of it lives right there, okay? The lack of openness. So what does that mean? Let's unpack this idea of openness even more. Here are some slogans and icons that tend to go along with the open personality. And this is why all you liberals pay too much for your Mac computers. You know? They're really getting you with that liberal-oriented advertising. So openness is all about intellectual flexibility. It's about tolerance of uncertainty and ambiguity and change. It's about nuance in your beliefs rather than thinking in black and white. And it doesn't just mean being okay with these things, it means wanting these things. So if an argument is put to you that's very black and white, as a liberal, you'll be very dissatisfied and you'll say, where's the nuance? Okay. I would postulate that these tend to be strong characteristics of scientists as well, making the scientific community as a whole very liberal, and the data support that, and I'll show you that. More broadly, what this suggests is that across different eras, across time periods, there's an exploratory side of human nature that tends to get expressed as the left in different countries, and then there's a more aversive or defensive or threat-sensitive side of human nature that tends to get expressed as the right. One loves change and embraces change. One is really disturbed by change and retrenches in the face of change. And so no wonder when we first got the left-right dichotomy with left-right spectrum for describing politics, that was what it described. It was in the context of the French Revolution. And it was one of the many assemblies, and I forget which one right now, but you sat on the right, and that became the right, and if you sat on the right, it was because you supported the ancien regime. You supported the way things were, and on the left were the revolutionaries, okay? And that's still, in a sense, the way the dynamic works. What I'm saying is that dynamic is underwritten by human psychology, and there's kind of a yin and a yang within humanity in terms of how many people are embracing of change and how many people want stability and structure. And people can shift over the course of their lifetime in relation to events. But there's also a psychological core that you sort of don't deviate from that much over the course of a lifetime. Within this whole openness, let's give it a little more detail. There's this trait called the need for cognitive closure, which is associated with the lack of openness. And if you have a high need for closure, Ari Kruglansky at the University of Maryland is the one who described this particular psychological characteristic, and he's developed a scale to measure it, and it's very well accepted. And there's a lot of research on the need for closure showing it in all aspects of life. But if you have a not high need for closure, what it means is that you need to feel certain, okay? You need to feel sure, and you don't like the gnawing uncertainty of not knowing. So when you are in this state, and we can all be in this state about certain things in our life, but some people are chronically in this state about all things, when you're in this state, what you want to do is you want to seize on a belief or a certainty, you want to grab onto it, and then you freeze. It's called seizing and freezing. You don't want more information. You don't want to admit more information because that messes up the certainty. Okay, so need for closure is associated with religiosity. Surprise, right? It's also associated with political conservatism. Those two are associated with each other too. And so how does this affect your views of science? Well, science upsets the apple cart, right? It's always changing. And it's always destroying the old certainties. So of course there's a lot of tension there. And there's research suggesting that anti-evolutionists are higher on need for closure, and though of course higher on religiosity. The Tea Party members, not only are they most in denial of global warming, but they're very sure of themselves, and they do not think they need any more information about the topic. So they got it down. There's no global warming. It's not something that needs to be relitigated. It's crankery. It's Al Gore made it up. Nope. I don't want to hear any more about it. Within the conservative ranks is a character called an authoritarian. Okay, and this is one of the most negative sort of psychological profiles. The authoritarian is high need for closure, low openness, thinks there's only one way of doing things. It's either my way or the highway. And what's most associated with authoritarianism is this black and white thinking. You're either with me or against me. And you defer, naturally, to the figures in authority. You think that they're right, and you want to crack down on the people who are defying authority. Now, there's some studies that show that right-wing authoritarians are also more selective in exposing themselves only to information sources that are congenial, like Fox News. So I think that that is actually helping to explain what's going on when conservatives deny reality. We have all this research suggesting that Fox News viewership is associated with just wrong beliefs. Okay? Wrong belief that global warming isn't caused by humans. Wrong belief that the economic stimulus bill didn't create any jobs. Wrong belief that President Obama wasn't born in the US, and on and on and on. And people think, oh, it's because Fox contains misinformation, so you watch it, you learn wrong things, you end up being wrong. Undoubtedly, that's true. But it might also be that if you're a conservative authoritarian, you select into the Fox information stream because you want the affirmation. And so this wrongness probably is going in both directions, so to speak. Okay, so I've beaten up on conservatives a bit. Liberals are also driven by their own psychology, and the things that they do and the things that they believe will be associated with that. So what if conservatives, if Fox appeals to conservatives, what appeals to liberals? And what do they select into because of who they are? Well, one of the things is higher education. We know that academia is overwhelmingly liberal. We know that science is overwhelmingly liberal. An amazing statistic, just 6% of members of the American Association for the Advancement of Science are Republican. 6%. That's the nation's and the world's leading scientific membership organization. College professors are only 14% Republican. Liberals have a much higher preponderance of advanced degrees than conservatives. Here's a quote from the academic sociologist Neil Gross. More so than ever before, the highly educated comprise a key constituency for American liberalism and the Democratic Party, one that may have surpassed a crucial threshold level in size. Why is that? Academia is like a playground for the liberal psychology. Conservatives think that going to college makes you liberal. No, I think being liberal makes you want to go to college. Right? Because you're going to meet all these different kinds of people, you're going to take all these different kinds of classes, it's going to be endless stimulation with novelty. Right? That's what the liberal loves, and sometimes they stay. They can't leave, and they get all these degrees. And in the process, they learn a lot about the norms of science, and they become very allied with the kind of thinking that scientists and researchers have. So you've got this natural relationship, natural allegiance between the liberal and the scientist. Okay, and that's what shows up in the data and why so few scientists are Republicans. So if we go back to this big data dump, you know, before I said lack of openness is fueling conservatives disagreeing with science, but clearly something is going on with not staying within the ivory tower as long. And so again, the cause is both sociological and also psychological. Both of them go together. It's never going to be an either or. The world is too complicated for that. But what it all adds up to, I think, is that this statement by Colbert is not only funny, although it is, but it actually is true. It actually describes something about the nature of the world and about the nature of politics, is that liberals adjust their beliefs more, and so they're more open to science for psychological reasons. Conservatives, psychologically less so, because science is always challenging those fixed beliefs. That's the dynamic. And I could cite polls showing that, you know, liberals are more right than conservatives all day. I'll just give you a couple. 64% of Republican voters in the 2010 election considered it not clear whether President Obama was born in the United States. 55% of authoritarians, but just 19% of non-authoritarians thought Saddam Hussein had been directly involved in the 9/11 attacks. Just 18% of Republicans and Tea Party members accept the scientific consensus that global warming is caused by humans. And on it goes. None of this means that liberals can't be wrong, okay? What this actually means is that we can predict when liberals will be wrong, right? Because we know something about their psychology too. And to really understand liberal wrongness and liberal denial of science, which is very important to understand. I don't know how many of you listened to the podcast Point of Inquiry that I host with the Center for Inquiry, but we just did a show about liberal wrongness, focusing on genetically modified foods. But there's others, and we can predict why those are the kinds of issues that liberals are going to be wrong about. Let me now call up the research from Jonathan Haidt. He does a slightly different research paradigm than the psychologists that study personality or psychological needs, like the need for closure. What he's looking at is what he calls moral intuitions. And what's going on here is that it looks like our responses to moral situations or moral dilemmas, including many of them that have political implications, seem to be automatic and emotional, and the way you feel about those situations occurs long before you're actually consciously thinking your way through the situations. This is the new science of the biology of morality, and it looks like morality is an evolved trait. And we have certain deep moral impulses. Okay, so for example, everyone feels long before they think there's something wrong with incest. Does that make sense? And so you go through all these different moral situations, and that's what you feel rather than think about them. So he's broken it down by the different kinds of situations. And then he's shown how liberals and conservatives have different responses. And he's got libertarians mixed in here. So that's really interesting, because libertarians are indeed a blend. So libertarians are the stripes, liberals are the white, conservatives are the solid. And you got seven kinds of moral foundations, as he calls them. So how much do you respond to situations in which harm is occurring? Okay? So for example, an innocent is being, you know, poisoned by an environmental pollutant, let's say. Someone who can't help themselves. How much do you respond to situations of inequality or unfairness? And you notice that liberals are scoring really high on harm and fairness. That seems to be the situations that most get them emotional, get them roused, okay? But conservatives have got all these responses, and this shows how it overlaps with the other research, that are different. They're much more strong on in-group loyalty. So somebody is betraying their group. Somebody is betraying their tribe. Conservatives are like, that's wrong. Liberals might think that's great. You gotta speak out. Can't conform. How much are you defying authority? Conservatives might think that that's much more wrong. Liberals might think that's great. The biggest difference, right, is on purity. So how much are you defiling, doing something that seems sexually disgusting or inappropriate, right? Something that makes you wrinkle your nose, makes you feel disgust. And there are studies correlating conservatives being against gay rights with this disgust impulse. Okay, a lot of that is going on. But I think Jonathan Haidt, I had him on Point of Inquiry, I said, do they just feel disgust towards liberals? And he said, yeah, I think that they do. And then you've got this thing about freedom. And freedom is really important. Both liberals and conservatives feel strongly about freedom, but they respond differently to two types. Liberals and libertarians are strong on lifestyle freedom. Keep out of my bedroom, mind your own business. Keep government out of my life. My personal life, but liberals are much lower than both conservatives and libertarians on economic liberty, which is, you know, let me keep all my paycheck, you know, it's too much government regulation, government shouldn't be getting involved in the economy, etc. Okay, the reason I show this is because you can see from this where liberals are going to be wrong. All you have to do is create a situation where innocence allegedly are being harmed, especially children, and there's inequality involved. So let's say a big corporation which has too much power is accused of poisoning children, and it's doing so through vaccines. Vaccines that were supposed to protect them from a variety of diseases instead of giving them autism. If the bad guy's a corporation, but the facts are wrong, because this isn't actually true, as happens to be the case in that example, it isn't true then you've got the game set up to make the liberal emotions fire, and you'll already be going down the garden path. And then you'll have the scientists say, but wait, that's not true. It's wrong. And then you'll have an interesting conflict within the liberal ranks, because the scientists are in that group too. And so it's not that liberals can't be wrong, because they might really go for this. Genetically modified foods is another, right? Big corporation, Monsanto, we hate it, and it's poisoning us. Except the facts are wrong. The foods are safe. Okay. But again, the liberals are going for it. It isn't that they can't believe wrong things, but it is that they behave differently than conservatives. Not only because they vest emotions in different kinds of claims, but also because of that conflict that happens with the scientific world, which is part of the team or part of the tribe, and there's huge dissension. You can't believe this. This is wrong. You're embarrassing us. You know, we're supposed to care about facts. You can't believe this. And so you don't see these kinds of ideas going mainstream in the same way. I think I said before, Republicans are majority creationists, majority global warming deniers. You won't find any of these wrong beliefs, vaccine denial, genetically modified foods are dangerous to eat, et cetera, you know, nuclear power is dangerous because it, you know, radiation traveling over long distances causing cancer to the whole globe. I mean, something that's an extreme view, but the view that Chernobyl killed a million people, these kind of things are not true. But you don't find this stuff going mainstream. The Obama administration is very pro-nuclear. So something happens, there's some kind of stopgap within liberalism that prevents this stuff from actually dominating policy. So that is my conclusion. It's not that liberals aren't biased, but that they are not the same and it doesn't play out in the same way. Now, this is still new research, so there's a lot more to learn. And I will just leave you with some of the what I think the most interesting research going on is now. It's the research, and this is the Political Physiology Laboratory at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln. It's the research that is going to help us link genetics to psychology, basically. And the intermediate link is going to be all of those things in the body, responses of hormones, physiological responses to situations. And so they're doing physiological research. And what they're doing is, you know, bringing liberals and conservatives into a lab. They assess their ideology in various ways, or assess their voting patterns. And then they, you know, hook them up to various kinds of measuring equipment. So there are eye trackers, which basically determine where your eyes go and how long they stay there when you're shown different sorts of images. And you don't really control this. When images are flashing on a screen, the eye motion where it goes, the gaze is pretty involuntary, at least at first. Then they're measuring things like skin conductance. So how much your sweat glands moisten when you see different kinds of images. And they're measuring startle reflex. You hear a loud noise. How quickly do you respond? And what they're finding is left-right differences in all these kinds of responses. So for instance, they'll show images that evoke fear and disgust. Okay, so something, an image evoking fear, a classic one would be, suddenly you see a person with a gigantic spider on their face. Okay, the conservatives, their eyes are going there faster, and they're staying there longer, and their sympathetic nervous system is getting aroused more quickly. Okay, then the liberals' eyes are darting towards a picture of a happy bunny rabbit instead. So literally, it looks like the two groups are going through the world perceiving different things, selectively paying attention to different things, some more attuned to threat and what in the environment could harm you, and some less attuned to threat. And this is, of course, a really basic and evolutionarily old kind of response. Okay? We have to be threat sensitive because we have to keep ourselves alive, and we're clearly wired to be that way, but we also have to be exploratory because we've got to seek out new things, we've got to take risks, and we're clearly wired to be that way. And it looks like this just varies person to person in ways that have political implications. That's the main upshot of the research. There's more going on all the time. We did a whole Point of Inquiry show about the research of Peter Ditto. And what he found, I'll just summarize it, because again, it gets to this idea of conservative bias. They looked at four separate issues: waterboarding, condom effectiveness, stem cell research, and the death penalty. And on all four, they found that conservatives, more than liberals, were likely to conform their beliefs about the facts of the issue with their moral views. Okay? So let's say that you are against sex before marriage. Okay, fine. That's your moral view. But the conservative, more than liberal, is likely to go from there to say condoms don't work. Right? Or let's say you believe in the death penalty. You think some crimes are so awful that there should be the ultimate punishment. Fine, that's a moral view, but the conservative is more likely to also say, oh yeah, and it deters crime. Does that make sense? So there's some way in which the conservative morality is shaping the views of the factual world in a way that it isn't happening with liberals. So we don't know everything about left and right, but there's a lot more to explore, and I do not think that this research is going away. So in conclusion, I'll leave you with the words of a profound philosopher, Yoda. Yoda said, you must unlearn what you have learned. And when it comes to why people will not accept what's true, why people disagree, and how you might be able to reach people who disagree with you, that is the situation that we're in. Thank you.
Okay, we have time for some questions. Please come up to the microphone and ask the question, and try to make it a question. Don't get into.
Yeah, as you know, to follow on Jeopardy, but bastardize it a little bit. Please phrase your question in the form of a question.
Yeah. And then use that mic then, and I'm going to take this from you.
I like what you've said, but seems like I think to a high degree you're. Well, it's basically everything on the American political spectrum, which mm-hmm. might not be the norm in other parts of the world. What about, how would that maybe transfer, hypothetically, to something like the Soviet Union, where the authoritarian power had, very leftist rhetoric, mm-hmm. Or what's considered conservative there would be the opposite, ideological.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. So I gave this talk in Germany, and there I actually I didn't tailor it to a European context, but I put up a list of citations at the end and I said, I know you're gonna ask me, what about Europe? And what the citations show is that for Europe, this basic association between left-right views and some of the psychological personality traits holds up in the same way as it does in the United States, even though there is very large variability in terms of what left-right means in different countries. And I think that if I remember in Denmark, the liberals are actually the conservatives, just to give one example. So it gets complicated, but nevertheless, the relationship between politics and personality and between need for closure and political views holds up. You ask a much more difficult question when you ask about the Soviet Union. And let me say that we don't have as much psychological research in some of these countries as we do in the West. And so that's a big problem, and that is a big gap. But what happens there is that, you started to give the answer. So there's this researcher, Robert Altmaier, who is the guy who did a lot of the early authoritarian research. And now some people measure authoritarianism differently. But he argues, he had a specific definition for what a right-wing authoritarian is. And a right-wing authoritarian is, wedded to certainty, thinking in black and white, and conformist, supporting existing authorities in society. And so his definition actually flips in the Soviet Union, and he would say that Soviet left-wing hardliners are right-wing authoritarians psychologically. That's what he argues. And so what he's basically saying is that in this Soviet context, the Soviet authoritarians were very socially conformist, accepting of authorities, accepting of cultural tradition. But somehow this becomes disassociated with the left-right economic axis. And that can happen. I mean, culture has a lot of power to mess with these more nature elements. So that's the account. And there's actually, in the book, I spend several pages answering that, what about left-wing authoritarian regimes? What's going on there? I answer that question in more detail. Because it is one of the big questions. Yes?
How do universities deal with the charge that, this is a conservative charge, that faculty is, promulgating liberal ideas. Basically, it just seems to be that universities are seeking more scientific truth, but then conservatives say that there's too few conservatives in this kind of situation.
Right.
How does a university deal with this?
It's very difficult because, in one sense, the conservatives are right. Okay, the data is clear. Universities are a liberal haven. They are a liberal part of society. But are you surprised? I mean, that's the way it is. And here's why conservatives, I should say, should respect this, is because that's the tradition, you know? That's the way human beings have done things. Universities are the places where liberals hang out. And conservatives have places where they hang out too. You know, they hang out in the military. They hang out in the business world, okay? And they run those places. And those places are more in line with their own psychologies, and they're happier there. Ultimately, we ought to get to an acceptance of the fact that people are different, and these differences have political implications, and so there are going to be parts of society where liberals feel good. But those play a vital role in society. The military plays a vital role. The universities play a vital role. The corporate sector plays a vital role. And yeah, there's ideological implications in terms of which sector you want to live in, you want to hang out in. But they're all important. So I wouldn't flinch from it. But what I would say is that universities are not liberal, and students aren't liberal because universities are brainwashing. All right? The evidence of brainwashing is really, I think, pretty slim. I think it's more of a self-selection. I think you're liberal, psychologically, disposition-wise, long before you go to a university. Right? I think you become the kind of person who wants to be at a university, and then it probably feels great for you and you want to stay. So it does not mean that professors are biased. That's a different argument. May be true, may not be true. I know a lot of them try their best to not be. But nevertheless, there's a whole self-selection of liberals into universities and self-selection of liberals wanting to stay at universities, and that's really real, and you cannot deny it. I mean, the data are too clear. So
I think this may be a related question. Do you have any numbers or educated guesses on the percentage of funding for American science that comes from the Department of Defense?
No, it's huge, though. It's a totally different research budget if you include the defense part or you don't include the defense part. And I forget the numbers, but I think that if you add together civilian research and defense research, then the United States' total science budget becomes bigger than the GDP of many countries. So don't quote me. I'm going to give you a ballpark of what I believe it is. I think then you're pushing $200 billion. But if you just do science that is non-military across a lot of different agencies, then you're more like the sort of $75, $80 billion. I know the National Science Foundation is about $7 billion, but there's all these. There's Department of Defense. There's Environmental Protection Agency. There's NOAA. Health and Human Services, National Institutes of Health is double, at least double, NSF, and it's like $14 billion. But the military's got this whole defense infrastructure that is about as big, again, as the civilian. Yeah.
So what is the implication for that 94% of AAAS members who are receiving those funds and are described as liberals? Are they looking the other way? Are they looking the other way in terms of where their funding's coming from?
Well, I would expect that not that many of those American Association for the Advancement of Science members are doing military science, a lot of which is not basic research, but is actually applied science to make technologies. I think that they're not fully the same group.
Well, university liberals.
Yeah. So what's the question? Are university liberals?
Are they, to some degree, looking the other way in terms of where their funding is coming from?
Well, I think most of their funding isn't coming from the military. There's still a lot of funding going around. So, I mean, that's the American Association for the Advancement of Science. It's not engineers, for instance. Engineers are more of a conservative group. We know that. Okay, so there's all these military engineers that are really very different than American Association for the Advancement of Science members.
I'd like to ask you about the where this fits in, this information fits in with the concept that people that grow up in a patriarchal family are more liable to be conservative, and people who are in a nurturing family where both parents contribute tend to be conservative, liberal, and then also how much is environment and how much is genes, because the genes play a role in patriarchal families. So yep. Could you comment on that, and how this fits in with that?
Well, are you referring to Lakoff?
What? Lakoff, yes.
Mm-hmm. So I discussed Lakoff in the book, and the way I think about Lakoff is he's one of the earliest scientists to really popularize this way of thinking, and he does so within his particular paradigm. And none of the studies that I've talked about are within Lakoff's paradigm. What I think that shows is that a lot of other studies come to conclusions similar to Lakoff, because when Lakoff talks about the basically male patriarchal family and the values that it instills, he's talking about an authoritarian family. And he's talking about a family in which the father is the absolute maker of all rules, okay? And the father teaches the children absolute right and wrong. And what Lakoff is basically doing is he's constructing two different models of families and how they run, and saying that the way the family runs, it actually has all these political implications. And I think that's really consistent with all of the psychology research that I'm talking about. It's just a different way of slicing it up, and I have no doubt that it's valid. You said something about then genes and environment. So here's the way I would think about that. The genetics of politics is a growing area. There's a lot of research, and there's some criticism of the research too. But what they have, one of the most dominant research techniques is called twin studies. And I talk about this in the book. And basically, you know, identical twins, so-called identical twins, they're not actually identical, but they do share all their DNA, right? And so, whereas so-called fraternal twins only share half. So any trait that is genetic, it's identical twins are going to be more similar than fraternal twins, especially when you look at large groups of them, large groups of identical twins versus large groups of fraternal twins. So hence the twin study. Get these large groups, and so they have twin registries, databases of twins, that they'll examine all these different traits to determine how much genes influence the trait. And so any trait that's genetic, you'll find this big difference between the groups of identical twins and the groups of fraternal. And so height is a great example. Clearly genetic, right? Clearly identical twins are going to be more similar in height than fraternal twins. So they started applying this to social beliefs, right? And people are shocked. Religiosity, okay? turns out to be the identical twins are much more similar than the fraternal twins. Politics, turns out they're much more similar. So how similar? And how genetic are these traits, therefore? And scientists, you know, try to divide it up into genetic, environmental, and they actually try to divide the environmental further. They say, you know, within the family growing up, environmental, and then after you leave the nest, environmental, and everything else that happens in your life. And one way of breaking it down suggests that it's about 40% genes, you know, 10% family, and then like the rest is everything that happens in your life after that. These are all estimates, okay? But that is the number that's one of the numbers that I've seen. I think that's the number I use in the book. So that is clearly not all genes. 40% is not all genes. On the other hand, 40% is a pretty big deal.
Well, you went into some very interesting detail about why liberals think they got it right and conservatives think they got it right and reasons why they go wrong. I was wondering if there's anything about the concept of critical thinking and how that will help us, either the conservatives or the liberals, to get it right and even come to the same answer?
Well, I think critical thinking is great in theory, and I think that both groups would embrace it. And yet, I think people will be more and less critical depending upon the emotional stake that they have, which comes from their ideology and who they are. And so what I don't think you can do is expect that if you could just get everybody to say critical thinking is good, then they would reason in a less biased way on some of these touchstone issues where they're highly invested. Because it looks like that isn't how it works. It looks like on some things you're so emotionally wedded, some political things, also some personal things, right? There's some, you're so emotionally wedded to a particular view of yourself or your party that you just reason in a biased way, and it comes prior to really rational thought, because you're set down the garden path by your investment in the topic. Yeah. I think the concept is idealistic, yeah. I think the Enlightenment is idealistic. I mean, I think that we didn't understand human psychology very well. And I think that it's been in the last, 30 years, really, that psychologists have finally really settled on the idea that emotions come before thoughts. I mean, that's kind of one of the big changes. There's a famous paper called Preferences Need No Inferences. Basically, you are processing information really rapidly before you're conscious of it. And only some of what you process are you ever conscious of. And so your emotional system is tagging all the information and controlling your responses to it before you necessarily even snap to consciousness. And when you snap to consciousness, you're going to be pushed in a direction if you have a stake. So it doesn't look like there's, pure rationality that exists outside of that. Now, that doesn't mean that arguments don't work, because arguments can be framed emotionally, and they can have a greater or lesser impact depending upon the framing. If you hear them repeatedly and you don't hear anything else, they'll influence you. I mean, so the brain changes, the emotions change. The emotions can change because of other emotions. They can change because of other arguments. That's true. But the emotions are playing a huge role in the whole system. So.
I very much enjoyed your talk.
Thank
first.
You.
My question is, when I have looked at similar issues of what divides or motivates liberals and conservatives, oftentimes it's the view of success, that I see conservatives viewing success as primarily based on hard work, dedication, delayed gratification, and the like, and diminishes the role of luck. And liberals are the inverse of that. They tend to think that that luck plays a much greater role in success, and that hard work and delayed gratification and the like somewhat less.
Yeah.
I'd like your thoughts on that. And in addition, I very much appreciated how you rated some of those issues of harm, fairness, and the like, which I certainly agree with. But can you say that the intensity of those? In other words, are there two or three things that above all drive someone to a conservative position? Are there two or three things above all that drive an individual to a liberal perspective? In other words, those aren't all co-equal. There's an intensity factor in.
Yeah, well, there. You see, I'll take the question first. You see the intensity factor, right? Because what it means is that on a scale of 1 to 5, liberals on average are 1 point more responsive to considerations of harm than conservatives. So it doesn't mean that conservatives don't respond to this. I think they have this emotion, but it's stronger in liberals,
okay,
right? And purity is where the biggest gap is, right? So liberals are around 1.25, I don't know, conservatives are going all the way up to 3, okay? So that means there's this whole palette of disgust emotions that conservatives are feeling much more intensely than liberals. But it doesn't mean that liberals have never felt disgust. Right? It looks like we all have all these emotions. But think of it as a knob. You can turn it up in different people. You can turn it down in different people. And then you talked about what constitutes success. I mean, I think that question is all or almost all under economic liberty. Maybe not entirely. There's different ways of slicing this up. But I think it's about economic liberty and to some extent about fairness. Okay, and it's different views of liberty and different views of fairness. And look, there's a really big difference on this feeling of economic liberty and how much it matters. Almost 2 points on the scale between the liberals and the conservative libertarians. Basically, to me, the economic liberty, it's also sometimes called individualism. And this is the view, and this is what you're talking about. This is the view that a fair society is one in which people get ahead or fall behind based upon their own merits, their own inherent merits. And you don't tilt the playing field to favor some over others. You just see who succeeds or who fails. And if you fail, you deserved it. That is the individualist, leave me alone kind of view. And that's, that gets manifested as economic liberty, keep the government out of things, because it shouldn't be tilting the playing field. So another way of answering this question is to say that there are very, very strong emotions attached to this, right? Does government solve things or does it not solve things? So whenever, you know, you hear big government, I mean, you should be like, okay, I don't expect rational argument to follow, right? This is just a giant stake around that whole world, whole word. And it, this is what it looks like when somebody tries to measure it.
One question. I was interested in your in-group discussion.
Okay.
How do you reconcile that with, and maybe it's a slightly different thing, that 90% of African Americans vote a certain way, that liberals tend to give a, you know, low, if I'm understanding that correctly, priority toward that, that you have great concentrations kind of on the left that vote a certain way. And I think even though white older males tend to be more conservative, it's not as monolithic as it is for African Americans. Increasingly Hispanics, to some extent, of the Jewish community. How do you reconcile those?
So, no, first of all, so everybody has an in-group preference, and you can see it right here. So everybody likes to hang out with people who agree with them. Everybody feels that their identity is tied to a group, but it looks like conservatives feel it more strongly. Now, the African-American community votes overwhelmingly Democrat, okay? I don't know what the percent is, but it's over 90, right? Okay, so basically, if you follow my thinking, within the African-American community of all different psychological profiles, all different kinds of people, psychological liberals, psychological conservatives. If they're overwhelmingly voting Democrat, that means you got some, you know, strange bedfellows, in effect, right? And so for sociological and cultural reasons, there's this affinity that actually is not representing a good psychological sorting of different people. So in that context, what you're going to get is all of them are exercising, I guess, an in-group kind of preference in terms of being Democrat. Some might be exercising it even stronger than others, and they might be psychological conservatives, right? Who, for sociological reasons, have affiliated that way. So this is a great example of how culture still matters a great deal, doesn't it? That's basically my history and culture still matter, and they can override some of these, yeah.
His last question was actually most of my question.
Okay.
But I also wanted to ask you why it is that the minorities tend to also poll more liberally for things like gay marriage and as far as taxes go and such.
Mm-hmm.
While at the same time usually being pretty religious.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the same sorting isn't going on. So they're not as well sorted. Psychologically sorted, and I think that, I mean, this is still a big deal, right? Income, predicting conservatism. And if you have a minority group that's disadvantaged socioeconomically, that's going to push them into the blue. I mean, that's definitely real. So it's still a big effect. So I think that that's the main reason. But I suspect you have a lot of psychological conservatives that are actually affiliating with Democrats. Just within Latino community or within the African-American community, remember, you had Reagan Democrats before Reagan who were Christian conservatives and had lived in the Democratic Party for a very long time and thought that that was their home in the South. And then they finally realized they were conservatives, but for decades, they were affiliated with Democrats because of the politics that came out of the New Deal. So all kinds of political changes can create tendencies and coalitions that to some extent go against the underlying psychology. But nevertheless, the underlying psychology still works as a good differentiator across countries in predicting left and right. So it's I think all of these questions are basically getting at the idea that you don't have nature or nurture in isolation, and no good scientist today thinks that you do. It's always a blend. And if I could use a metaphor, think about personality traits as like the plates that move continents, all right? And then think about political affiliations and party affiliations as where you draw the country borders, okay? So the plates are always there, they're always moving, but then people are, you know, all these things are going on in terms of how people are dividing up what's my country and what's yours.
Question, why do you think the conservatives, religious, and rich are against science?
Oh, I think that's my whole talk. I think basically, closed-mindedness, psychological closed-mindedness, need for closure, less openness to new experiences, and also group affiliation against scientists because they think they're liberal. And so they're not going to accept what they think, and they don't have high levels of trust for them.
But is it, I guess, why I wondered, is that willingness to learn? Is that another triangle?
Well, I think openness to experience implies more of a hunger for new ideas and new experiences. So you might say less, I don't know, it's about willingness as much as desire. Desire for novelty, including novel information.
Just to follow on the same question, the reason we're able to create wealth is to take material, convert by energy and other means into wealth, and that's exactly what they're against. Oh, I'm sorry.
Who's against it?
Well, I'm saying is the way I've been able to put together and saying people who have the wealth, or the conservatives, they are against the science and energy and the combination has created wealth.
Yeah, but I mean, it's a little more nuanced because a lot of engineers are conservative. So a lot of people who are taking basic scientific ideas and turning them into products are actually not necessarily politically liberal. So it's a little more, so when I say science, I'm talking about more the basic academic research community, not necessarily the people that link that community to industry and to what we think of as technological innovation. So there's a bit of a difference there.
I guess the thought is that the process is continuous. I mean, you can't really quantify these things in that.
Well, they try, but precise. I mean, you know, you find consistent correlations between psychology and ideology. And they use statistical techniques to try to give a measure of the correlation. But yeah, different studies, there'll be variation, but you find it consistently. So, and in surveys, you can quantify what percentage of scientists are liberal. You know, what percentage of Republicans believe President Obama is not born in the U.S. or is a Muslim. I mean, you can quantify a lot of things.
Yeah. Okay, within the context of this analysis, where does the abortion issue fit in? It seems to be the opposite of some of these other issues.
I think you've got conservatives responding to harm. I think you've got conservatives responding to disgust. I think you've got conservatives responding to authority, religious authority. So I agree that it actually, you know, in terms of how they think about abortion, I think it touches several of these moral foundations. Right? But I think that the authority would be strong in terms of religious authority. And then it's their version of harm to those who can't protect themselves. That's what they think it is.
Okay, well, my question has to do with climate change. I just wonder what it's going to take for, you know, I mean, Republicans, it looks like they don't, you know, they tend to not believe in anthropocentric climate change. But, with recent extreme weather events, like the drought last year and you know, tornado outbreaks, I just wonder if you've seen a shift in Republican thinking towards you know, accepting anthropocentric climate change,
yeah,
there's been any movement.
It's anthropogenic. Anthropocentric, humans better than everybody else. So weather is clearly the most powerful thing that moves the needle of public opinion about global warming. And that's become clear. And in the last couple years, there has been a shift towards acceptance, and there's been a dwindling of the denial community in correlation with weird weather. So that cohort has lessened. I think that to some extent there's different groups of Americans and how they feel, and there's all these people in the middle that are sort of a weather vane, and they're most sensitive and they move the most because they know the least, right? So they'll probably swing back because this winter was cold, basically. But what that does, that movement, is it creates political opportunity because it creates a mass of people that are ready for something to happen, that are in favor of something to happen. Whether that gets seized on or not, I don't know. I mean, the Congress, the conservative part of the Congress, is still very ideologically opposed to even the existence. And especially in the 2010 election, between 2008 and 2010, the Republican caucus got more denialist. I don't know if has it swung back any since then? That's an interesting question. I don't really know the answer to that. But it's still very denialist.
Other than genetically modified foods, can you think of other topics that liberals tend to get the science wrong?
Yeah. So I think genetically modified foods is very big. I think vaccines is big, although interestingly, when you do polling data, you find that you don't get that much of a left-right difference in terms of believing that vaccines are dangerous. It seems to be across the spectrum, which is odd, because I think the emotionality of how the issue is presented should appeal to liberals, and I know that it's in these kind of granola liberal cities like Boulder, Colorado, where people are going unvaccinated. So I'm not sure what's going on with that. I still think of it as liberal, but I always have to use that little qualifier. Nuclear power. Right. I talk in the book, I do a long bit about nuclear power and explaining how, at least on the issue of low-dose radiation traveling at long distances and what the risk is, liberals tend to be more out of whack with what scientists think than conservatives do. Okay, and at the extreme, that includes saying that vast numbers of people died or got cancer in a Chernobyl, in a Fukushima, because of low-dose radiation traveling long distances, and really inflating those numbers, I would say that is getting the science wrong, or at least being very distant from the view of the scientific community on risk about this. In the book, I talk about fracking. I think that the fracking argument has gotten way outside of the scientific sphere and has gotten into the moral sphere for liberals, and they think about big, bad companies basically destroying communities, and they've got their emotions firing, and I think that emotional firing has gotten beyond some of the science, because it looks like while water is definitely being polluted, it's not at all clear that fracking is the cause, if you want to get technical about it. Fracking is sort of a specter. Really what's happening is just gigantic amounts of drilling going on in places that are not used to it, and then all kinds of contaminations occurring from drilling, but fracking is happening. Is something that actually happens after the drilling process. And so to make fracking the issue seems to me like a red herring a bit. What you really are opposed to is massive industrialization going on all over America, and you can understand why. But I think that saying that fracking is the problem sort of misunderstands what it is. So those are some examples.
Someone mentioned before a little bit about the age difference, and in my life, I realized that most of the older people do tend to be conservative. The younger people, I think, tend to be more liberal. Mm-hmm. Is this true, or does this have anything?
Yeah,
to
I
do
mean,
with?
I've seen some evidence to suggest that authoritarianism might increase with age. Generally, the personality traits are mostly stable over the lifetime; they don't change that much. You also got income, again, correlating with conservatism, and income presumably increases, or savings increase, and then you might become more protective of them. So I think that it is natural to think that conservatism increases with age. I think that there's makes sense to me. I think it fits.
Okay. Okay, let's thank Chris again for
thanks.
Wonderful presentation.
So I got some more books, and I'll be outside.
And he still has a few books left out there. I'd be happy to sign for you. Thanks for coming. Hope you enjoyed it.